Something that strikes me about your writing, it sounds quite studied. I want to know if it's conscious or if you instinctively think that way. Like, for instance, that riff in Don Quixote.
Right.
Where you have all the repeated notes go three times, then four times, then five times. It goes da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da. So three, four, five, like that.
Yeah.
Now, did you think that, or is that just how it came out?
In that particular instance, it was just how it came out. But there's lots of reasons why things happen. And for instance, the main riff running through that song was just the noise a JP60 makes when you press a certain button. And the arpeggiator in the JP, well, I think it was a JP6 or J something or other keyboard. The bass line. Yeah, that bass sequence through the whole thing. That's the arpeggiator. That's what it does.
Okay.
So I'm thinking, okay, I'll sing over that a bit. And there's your song. Thank you very much. Ka-ching. But so there's sometimes it happens like this. But I must admit, I was aware of getting a reputation for certain things, like certain modulations and stuff like that. And I did find myself guilty of actually doing it on purpose.
Yeah.
At some point, just so people could think how clever I was, which is not really what you should be doing when you're writing songs.
Self-parody.
Yeah, exactly. But recently, I mean, the more recent stuff is just, if I like it, that's the only thing I have to worry about is if I like it or not.
But I mean, one of my favourite tracks is still Cowboys and Indians.
Yeah.
Whether that's surprising or not, I don't know. It's 3-4 and you've got 1-2-1... And 3-1-2-1 da. So it's very studied. Do you actually think that, or is it that just how it comes out? It is consistent because of your musical brain.
That's how it sounds in my head when I'm thinking of it. Yeah, pretty much that. But another example in that track is the way the chorus turns round. So it's the two halves of the chorus are in slightly different keys.
Yeah.
But then it comes back and then it ends up in the key you started with. And I don't know how that happens. You know, those things are just lucky for me. You just see where a tune takes you and where it modulates. And if it ends up somewhere, it just ended up where it was. That's brilliant. How did that work? How did that happen?
When you repeat the chorus, yeah, that's right.
Yeah. I'm a genius.
Well, you see, that's what talent is. You know, that's part of what talent is native musicality. Really. That interests me a lot because there are things that you tend to do, like, you know, when the bass goes up a tone, probably the chord's actually a tone lower, so it's going E, D, F sharp bass, then a G chord, then an A chord, then the A stays there and it's an F chord.
So you're talking chords to me now, yeah. Reg. You completely lost me.
I will demonstrate. E, D, F sharp bass, G, A, F, A bass, B flat, G minor, C, F, E flat, G bass, A flat, B flat, G flat, B flat bass, B, A flat minor, D flat, E flat minor. Cowboys and Indians with the drummer, Mr. Vinnie Colaiuta, in truly majestic form.
See, I don't. That's the intro, because I don't know about the nuts and bolts. You know, I just and it does fascinate me. I kind of somehow think, what if I knew more about the rudiments and how this is actually working, and all the mathematics of it all, then I'd be able to do it better. Then I think, well, hang on a minute, then maybe that would stop me doing it. I don't know. Because it's like, if you don't know some of the rules, then you don't take any notice of them and you just...
Well, I think probably if you didn't observe your own rules, it would sound like rubbish to you. So...
Yeah, I guess so.
I don't think you'd naturally do that anyway. For instance, you know, there was this phase in pop music for ripping all the chords out of a tune.
Yeah.
And it was alleged to be hip for a while. And it was absolutely dreadful, in my opinion. I'd hear these perfectly decent songs being played over a bass loop, which had not much to do with the tune that was being sung. And I think, yeah.
But that's not necessarily artists' fault. They probably sung over a different track.
Yeah.
That's the great thing. And then some geezer with his cap on back to front decided to remix it in a totally erroneous key.
Yeah.
And then the artist gets the blame. You know, you're singing out of tune.
And of course, if they can then sell that stuff as it is, it kind of fosters this kind of...
Then it becomes the rule rather than the exception. Yeah. I know.
And that's what really bothers me. You know, your career demonstrates that musical values aren't necessarily the enemy of success. But after the works, we have this rather worrying 10-year gap.
I only popped out for a pint of milk.
So what happened then? What happened after the...
Well, the works, I think, you know, that was the nail in the coffin, the works, because we spent a fair bit of money recording it, as you can imagine. And again, when I came back from LA, where's my record company? It's changed again. There's someone else. I've got a different A&R person. I've got a different managing director, none of which know me or what's been going on in my past, or even, you know, it's like, who are you? Oh, I've just come in from LA. I'm just made a record. Do you want to release it? I think I redid quite a lot of the stuff we did in LA back in England, because I wasn't madly happy about it. A lot of things were happening at that time. One is we did a tour with Elton, did a support tour with Elton in Europe, which was a total waste of time.
Because
it wasn't a waste of time. I guess it wasn't. It was a good experience to do, but it was obvious from the start, from when we went on that tour, that MCA were not going to sell this record. I mean, it's bizarre because of the fact that they wanted to financially support. If you're doing a support tour, you ain't getting paid.
No.
So you've still got all the expenses of doing a tour, the traveling, the gear, the rehearsals, the musicians, you know, just keeping people alive on tour for 9 weeks or however long. But you've got no income whatsoever. So it's completely lost money. So they didn't mind paying for that for some reason, but they weren't going to pay any money to promote it. And plus the fact it was a Muso album. I've got so many Musos coming up to me. It's like, oh, Jeff Beccaridge, oh, God, Paulinho Di Costa, God, Vinnie Colaiuta, which is great and on a certain level, but it probably made it quite inaccessible to a lot of people. And there weren't any great, for me, there weren't any great songs on that album. There weren't any sort of... Well, put it this way, when I do live shows now, I don't do... any songs from that album, apart from Cowboys and Indians, because it's fun.
Yeah. It's, I think that's pretty accessible.
Well, it is, because most people don't know what's going on, you know, because I don't know what's going on when I wrote it. I don't know what's going on when I'm playing it, so people probably know what's going on when they're listening to it. But yeah, either it resonates with them or connects with them or it doesn't. You know, it's the same as a lot of music. But anyway, I came off tour with Elton and basically I got the phone call. Well, no, I didn't even get the phone call. I did get it in person, I think, from Tony Powell, who was the managing director at that time, saying they weren't going to renew my option with MCA Records. So I thought, oh, fair enough. okay. What do I do now? But basically, so I decided to throw everything up in the air. My publishing came up at the same time. My management contract came out the same. My management went, my publishing went, everything went. And I started again. I didn't want to go to some little label somewhere and try and do it because I'd had enough. And then we just had Rudy, my first son, and I wanted to be around to watch him grow up. So I thought, well, this is going to be easy. I'll just sit at home and I'll write songs and get famous people to record them and get the money. That's great. Fantastic. No problem. And I got lulled into a false sense of how easy or difficult it was going to be by the fact that the first song I took to Warner Chappell Music, who were going to be my new publishers, happened to end up at number one for 5 weeks. So I thought, oh, this is easy. But of course, then I spent the next 10 years trying to repeat it, and it just didn't happen. So, but that's what happened for 10 years, basically, or 9 years. I was writing and producing for and with other people.
Anything stand out from that period that you remember now, or is it all a bit of a blur?
It's a bit of a blur. You get to meet a lot of great people, and you get to work with other people. You learn a lot about songwriting as a craft, because obviously early on I was just doing what I was doing before, and I take songs in and they go, well, it sounds a bit like Nick Kershaw. I think, okay.
Not utterly surprising.
No, not utterly surprising, but I can see the problem there, getting some, you know, Whitney Houston to sing that one. So, yeah, you start learning it as a craft, which is really difficult. It's bloody difficult, because basically what you're doing or trying to do a lot of the times is writing songs for people that you haven't even got in your record collection.
No.
That you don't listen to.
You don't necessarily like.
No, or don't necessarily like. So it becomes a job. And that's ultimately, I guess, what frustrated me so much at the end of the 90s and why I started recording again.
And we got 15 minutes.
Yeah. Well, 15 minutes was made up of just bits and pieces I'd lying about, because they were it was obvious that no one else was going to sing these bits or put a riff like that on their track. So yeah. It was a collection of stuff, and I just sort of stuck it together and was recording it, not knowing really what I wanted to do with it. I just recorded it and was having fun recording it.
Was our mutual friend Dave Bronze on there?
Yeah, he was. Yeah, I gave Dave a call for everybody out there. Dave Bronze is a bass player from the environs of Southend, and he was in a rival band when Fusion were around, wasn't he? What were they called?
Black Gold.
Black Gold. Yeah, and he was a bloody good bass player. He went touring with Robin Trower. He's played with Clapton. He's played with loads of people, hasn't he?
Yep.
And I gave him a call and said, do you want to play some bass? And he played all the bass on that album.
And it sounds good.
Again, retrospect, hindsight's a wonderful thing. It was produced and mixed quite aggressively, which makes some of the songs not to everybody's taste, but there's some good songs on there. There's my proudest moments on that album as far as songwriting.
Such as? Something.
Well, for instance, lyrically, I think Billy is the best lyric I've ever written. Usually take a long time over lyrics, certainly for my own songs, in about 5 minutes for other people's. But you... Sometimes just stuff comes together, and it's just a matter of luck. In that you'd be sitting, you're writing, you know, you've got a certain rhyming scheme in your head, and just things flow, and you want a word to say this, but it needs to have this many syllables, and it has to rhyme with that, yep. And you can spend the rest of your life finding these things.
Yeah.
But in the space of about 3 hours, this whole thing fell into place, and it just doesn't happen.
Best he can to figure out what it's about and what the hell he's meant to be. He does the right thing when expected, enough respect once in a while. He likes a smoke and a joke, just as long as it's PC. And he thinks that he cries at the movies, 'cause he's in touch with his feminine side. Sally wants a proud man, Sally wants a proud man, Sally wants a proud man, but she's taking all his pride. Billy is a new man, at least when she's around, a model father, or if needed, he'll be mother for the day. Watches men behaving badly, though he'll gladly switch it off if she's offended. He'll pretend it wasn't funny anyway. He's got one face he keeps for his woman, one for when he's out with the guys. Sally wants a true man, Sally wants a true man, Sally wants a true man, Swissers are okay. He drinks non-alcoholic lager, though he'd rather have a scotch. And he tries very hard to be happy, but there's a few little things in the way. Billy wants a good girl and a bad girl and a blonde girl and a brunette or a bond girl and a housemaid and a tease maid and a French maid, yeah, sex aid and a goddess and a confidant, a wet nurse and an agony and a lover, mother, babysitter, a young girl with a pretty face and smart but not too smart to love an asshole, yes, an asshole, but he wants to be an asshole. Singing, he wants it all.
I'm bound to ask the obvious question. Is he a person or just an idea?
He's an idea, but he's part of me. Yes. Absolutely, Billy. But I've since discovered I'm playing it to people, usually from people's girlfriends, that is certainly part of a lot of other blokes as well. You know, yeah. It's just trying to be, knowing what it is to be a man in or at that time in the 90s, but to be a new man, to know what you're supposed to be, or the definition of masculinity, you know, it's difficult, and that song was just trying to suggest how complicated and difficult it was. Confused, I think, is the word.
1999, so no more 10-year gaps, thank goodness. We've
I cut it down to about 3 years, yeah, for that one.
Well, I think, to be frank, it's 2001.
That's right, yeah.
And good album. You're not going to get much critical out of me about your music, because I tend to think, oh, this is my favourite track on this album. Then the next track comes on and there's a good bit, and I think, oh, that's a great bit, that. And any piece of music has got a good bit in it, you know.
Yeah.
I'm sold. Yeah, I'm not difficult, as long as it's got good bits in it. I think Wounded gets the album off to a good start. Nice Latin thing to it.
I do like a bit of 6/4.
Yeah.
You see, my reasoning, it's two better than 4/4.
Yeah, you know, that's right. That's good.
You know, most people have 4. I've got 6.
It's a fairly Spinal Tap
philosophy. Yeah, no, I do gravitate towards 6/4. It's like a 6/4 version of La Bamba, really, the Wounded thing. For some reason, everything I did just made it sound more like La Bamba. When I got the trumpet player in to do all that overdub stuff, it's just, yeah. Well, there you go. That finishes off.
Who did the piano?
The piano was me programming. My frantic best to try to make something.
Salsa piano, yeah.
Like, it would have been a lot easier, a lot less time-consuming to actually get someone to play it in the first place. Mm. But yeah, I'll be on the phone next time, Rich.
Good man. That would be enormously interesting to me. On the Billy tip about people or ideas, show them what you're made of. Is that a person or an idea?
Most of them are ideas. In general, there are very, very few of them. I find it very difficult to write about specific people or about me specifically. Or if I do write about me, I write it sort of vicariously through someone else. I guess it's sort of whole vulnerability thing going on.
Get Up's a bit about you, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It was just trying to give myself a kick up the arse, really. Show them what you're made of is just saying goodbye to a friend, really, or to a loved one, and not sort of owning them and just sort of letting people go is about what that's about, yeah.
You're putting on your brave face, packing up your bag, plucking up the courage you didn't know you had. The demons and the doubters fighting in your head, they'll go quiet when you knock them dead. so long, my old friend. Show them what you're made of. So come follow your way, and I will follow mine. Take it to the limit, but don't ever cross the line. Write me when you get there. Don't forget the kid. Though I would never blame you if you did. So long, my old friend. Hope we get to laugh again. So peace of me, wherever you may go.
You think that's a good song?
I think that's a good song. It's not something I would normally do. I mean, just sitting down on acoustic guitar and playing a song is not something that I'd done previous to that. And the whole string thing was new to me as well, the string arrangements and stuff. I'd had the tune for the verse in my head for years and years and years and never known what to do with it. Sometimes how that's how songs happen. Bits that you've had lying about for